Thank you very much, Katrin, for the kind introduction, and thanks for the EFAC for welcoming me back into the Institute colloquium slot. So, so it's not much of a surprise that I'll talk about coastal protection tonight, and specifically about soft coastal protection practices. And people often refer to this as coastal protection that works with nature and not against it. So hence also the title of the talk and the title of my book and PhD project. But I, before I sort of explain this further, I would actually want to briefly situate my work also in the conceptually in the Bremen Nature Culture Lab. So my approach to the topic is situated at the intersection of cultural anthropology, geography, and science and technology studies. So what I would also like to achieve with the talk is to demonstrate how ethnography can address an issue such as coastal protection. So this is a topic that is rarely seen as something that the social sciences have much to say about. It's usually a topic for engineering, and social aspects might be addressed in integrated coastal zone management, but here as well, social sciences are often expected to contribute as a service discipline and to produce knowledge that is adaptable to applied or management contexts and also quantifiable. However, there's probably no doubt that the coast is abound with meaning and with cultural significance. And for example, beaches are iconic landscapes with cultural as well as economic values. But I also not limit what I want to say about coastal protection to only speaking about the production of meaning at the coast or about human perceptions of coastal environments. Because that would mean to understand nature as something that is just out there, existing out there, which is then given meaning by humans. So, but of course, humans interact with coastal processes, with natural processes in general, but at the coast, I think it's especially evident because there's such a long history of human-nature interaction as well. So there is no nature out there, no coastal wilderness in the places I will talk about in New Zealand. So what can be found there are coastal nature cultures, entanglements of humans, non-humans, plants, sediment flows, weather and water. So in the following, I will focus on the coast as a site where nature cultures are coming into existence. What I will focus upon are the material practices of coastal protection and the kinds of coastal natures that they co-produce. As Katrin has said, my talk is based on research in New Zealand, or Aotearoa. So Aotearoa is the name of the country in the indigenous language Te Reo Māori. The research has originally been carried out as a PhD project in the scope of Intercoast, which is an interdisciplinary research training group. Intercoast stands for Integrated Coastal Zone and Shelf Sea Research. And as Katrin has mentioned, it's a collaboration between the University of Bremen and Waikato University in New Zealand. So I have split the talk in three parts. In the first part, I will give you a brief introduction on coastal erosion, on the situation in New Zealand, on coastal protection, and this difference that's being made between hard and soft protection. I will argue that there's a paradigm shift in the making towards coastal protection that works with nature and not against it. And I will also introduce some of the literatures that are used to understand coastal protection as a social material practice. Part two is based on empirical material. I will concentrate on different coastal protection projects which I encountered in my fieldwork in Aotearoa, New Zealand. I will discuss the examples under what I have named four different logics of making coastal nature cultures. And finally, in part three, I will discuss how natural and cultural orders are made and stabilized in such projects. Coastal protection, I will eventually argue, is not only a social material practice, it is also a practical politics of nature. New Zealand is an island nation located in the South Pacific. So here you can see that there's a lot of water around it. It has a very long coastline of an estimated 15 to 18,000 kilometers. There's no location in New Zealand that is more than 130 kilometers away from the sea. People often feel very connected to the coasts, and two-thirds of the population also live coastal. That means not more than 5 kilometers away from the shore. Some settlements are so close to the sea that they are impacted by coastal erosion. So what to do in a case like Waihi Beach, here on the left, which is a small village in the Bay of Plenty coast, where about 80 beachfront properties were endangered by ongoing erosion. The IPCC defines three ways of reacting. To retreat, that means to take away houses from the coastal zone, move them further inland. So Jan Schewe is working on that further down on the North Island at the Kapiti coast, also New Zealand. And the second would be to accommodate, which is not commonly done in New Zealand, or I haven't encountered that. Or to protect with hard or soft measures. The IPCC also defines, also lists what it defines as hard or soft options. Hard options include structures built alongside the coast, like seawalls or revetments, or structures built perpendicular to the coast, like groynes. Soft options include dune building or dune restoration, as well as more large-scale interventions, such as beach nourishment, using large quantities of sand to refill the beach, or artificial reef creation. In practice, I found that there are different logics at play in defining what counts as soft protection. So it might be that the material is the defining factor, like sand in contrast to rocks or concrete. Or it can be about the process and the scale of the intervention, or about removability of the structure in principle. This distinction between hard and soft protection also has a normative dimension. And people cut short and they say that soft protection is coastal protection that works with nature and not against it. And I'll come back to that later. What you can see here are sort of two different ends of the scale, so to speak. So on the one hand, you can see a large rock structure that's used to protect private property on a public beach. And on the right hand, you can see a dune restoration project where volunteers plant native dune plants to prevent an undeveloped beach from further eroding. The coastal space is limited, and erosion can become a massive problem. Climate change is a factor in this, but it's not the only way in which humans are entangled in erosion issues. Coastal environments are dynamic, while humans intend to use coastal space permanently. And not only the climate changes, the coastlines are also subject to social and economic change, to ongoing development booms, rising property prices, and coastal armoring that is built to protect these values. And structures built for coastal protection can have unintended effects on coastal processes. So for example, while seawalls can be very effective in protecting the land behind, they do not stop erosion in front of the wall. This can cause an effect called coastal squeeze, where you lose an accessible high tide beach, like on top left, for example. In this sense, coastal erosion is always a socio-natural phenomenon. It's not just part of a natural sphere outside of human influence, nor is it only an effect of human actions and perceptions. So consequently, how to deal with this is also a socio-technical question. So on this slide, you can see further pictures from Waihi Beach, a development that had been put too close to a changing shoreline during the first coastal boom in New Zealand after World War II. The area picture here on the top right shows the development in the year 1955. The first erosion problems occurred already in the late 1950s. Various hard protection structures have been installed since the 1960s. The protection works made people feel safe, and over the years, they extended and upgraded many of the once simple beach houses. So today, some of these properties, beachfront properties, are worth several million dollars, dollars NZ, but still quite a lot of money. When the protection works had to be replaced by something new, because they were just going derelict, the local council went through a long process of looking for options. Finally, in 2006, the council decided to build an even larger seawall. But those residents living further back from the beach strongly opposed this plan. They wanted the beach to look everywhere like in the part on the bottom right, where no houses are, and the dunes have space to grow, cared for by a local dune restoration group. The seawall opponents were supported by a number of popular coastal experts and scientists who helped to try and stop the project in the Environment Court, at an Environment Court appeal. These coastal experts also believed that the seawall was an example of an outdated and wrong approach to coastal protection. However, as you can also see, they have not been successful, and the construction project finally went ahead from 2011 onwards. So there are also some similarities here, which I won't go into detail, but if you have followed the situation on Sylt, for example, you may be aware that the southern tip of Sylt, the so-called Hörnum Odde, has been eroding increasingly quickly over the last decades. And this has also been further accelerated by the effects of hard protection structures of these large tetrapods, large concrete blocks, actually, However, with the Hörnum Odde, the question is how to protect an eroding natural reserve or a nature protection area. So that's like a mixing up of two different senses of coastal protection. Anyway, we can go back to this in the discussion, but back to New Zealand, the Waihi Beach case demonstrates that there is actually a growing sense in New Zealand that seawalls destroy coastal landscapes. So why coastal house owners, and that not only in the community of Waihi Beach, elsewhere as well, tend to argue in favor of hard protection structures, concern does grow over the visual effects, the externalization of economic and environmental costs, and the loss of beach access, which are all issues connected to such structures. So the coastal management expert I quote here on the slide warns that seawalls might kill the golden goose so that they might destroy a coastal nature of nation-building character. And recent coastal policy is evidence to the political will to move beyond hard protection where possible. The New Zealand Coastal Policy Statement 2010 advises local and regional authorities to, quote, discourage the use of hard protection structures and promote the use of alternatives to them, including natural defenses, end of quote. This is advised especially for the protection of private property and for structures to be built on public land. The growing popularity of soft protection, however, is not limited to Aotearoa, New Zealand. There is a rethinking of coastal protection underway that can be observed worldwide. As I mentioned before, actors in the field often frame such approaches simply as a matter of working with nature and not against it. So here you can see some evidence for this discourse, for example, an upcoming conference of coastal engineers in Australia who have chosen working with nature as this year's conference theme. So working with nature, I want to argue, is a socio-technical imaginary in the making. I take this concept of socio-technical imaginaries from science and technology studies scholar Sheila Jasanoff. Social imaginaries express visions of desirable, feasible futures and of how those could be achieved in relation to the use of science and technologies. The socio-technical imaginaries have a normative dimension. They address how a desirable common future could be achieved or in Jasanoff's words, and I quote here, how life ought or not be lived. The concept addresses the relation between discourses and practices, and it also addresses the materialities, meanings, and moralities of science and technology in society. So I argue here that the emerging idea to work with nature in the field of coastal protection and management is evidence to a new social-technical imaginary. And this imaginary provides a shared understanding of how New Zealand's coasts should be shaped now and in the future, and of the appropriate approaches and technologies to achieve this. But as I said, I also do not intend to take nature here as a stable background, as nature out there, which simply provides the stage for the practices I want to look at. I do not understand nature as a separate domain, completely outside of human society and culture, nor would I reduce nature to a mere social construction. So I follow a co-productive understanding of nature, which is put forward, for example, by the British geographer Steve Hinchliffe, whose book you can see here on the right, Geographies of Nature. Hinchliffe is part of a larger strand of scholars from geography, anthropology, and STS who write against the idea that there is only one universal nature, or what might be called capital N nature in the English language. Instead, natures become multiple when Hinchliffe argues that natures emerge from practice or material practices. Then this understanding, natures are stabilized assemblages of practices, they are outcomes and achievements. So what I take from the strand of theory is that coastal protection might also be understood as a social material practice, a practice of making nature or natures involving human and non-human forces. So moving from the library to the field for the second part of the talk, the leading question is the following. Which specific coastal nature cultures are emerging from the soft protection projects that I have encountered in my New Zealand fieldwork? New Zealand's coastal sand dunes have experienced large-scale environmental change due to the effects of coastal development, but also cattle grazing, vehicle use, and the effects of invasive animals and plant species. In many places, the dunes have lost their barrier function against the sea. Only in the 1990s, the first dune restoration projects began in New Zealand. Until today, dune restoration is almost exclusively carried out by volunteers, organized in so-called Coast Care or Dune Care projects. Coast Care is a program that receives funding from various government agencies and in turn supplies volunteers with dune plants, fertilizer, tools, information, and training on planting, weeding, and pest control. Some people engage in Coast Care understand this practice as kind of a do-it-yourself approach to coastal protection. It is something that they can do by themselves to fix erosion problems and protect their coastal property. Fixing the dune means planting and caring for native sand-binding plants. These plants have an impact on the erosion and accretion cycles of the shoreline. So during storms, sand is washed away from the foredune. It is deposited offshore, underwater, and from there it is slowly transported back to the beach. The dune plants used by Coast Care, the native plants called Spinifex and Pingo, mostly Spinifex, a native plant in Pingo, an endemic plant in New Zealand, develop long rhizomes or root runners that trap the sand. This helps the rebuilding of the dune. When the plants are washed away, as well, the volunteers will replace them with new ones. This is why the owner of a native plant nursery who supplies these plants to the council calls them sacrificial plants. Besides planting dunes, weeding, so the removal of unwanted plants, is another important coast care task, I should say. In this example here, this natural recovery of the four dunes is accelerated even more. At a site in Fangapoa, house owners have chosen a technique that builds on the coast care approach, but instead of just planting and weeding, here the dune itself is reconstructed first. So sand is scraped off the beach with a digger and pushed back to form a new dune. Then the dune is planted to stabilize it. The house owners have chosen this form of protection as an alternative to a seawall. This keeps their beach, and it's also considerably cheaper than the construction of a seawall. While this approach works in the short term, it cannot fix the problem permanently. So you can see what happened. On the left, you see the freshly shaped and replanted dune in the year 2010 when I saw it the first time. The picture in the middle shows the same location in the following year after another major storm event. After that, the dune actually managed to rebuild without intervention, and you can also see these runners, these root runners that I mentioned, which trapped the wind-blown sand. But then in 2015, another major storm hit. And this time, actually, a new scraping was undertaken, and the results you can see on the right. So it's still without plantings, just a bare dune. So this approach speeds up the recovery of the dune that without intervention would have taken several years or might even not have been possible at all, given the limited space of the dune in front of the houses, because they are quite close. So dune restoration is used as a coastal protection approach on the basis of the understanding that a dune covered with native plants offers better protection. Not only better protection than a dune without vegetation, but also better protection than a dune covered with introduced plants, including the European dune grass Ammophila arenaria, or marum. So New Zealand marum has been widely planted, but it is said to form the wrong kind of dunes, too steep, whereas the native plants form a more gentle slope, what you can see here on the right, which is said to be typical for New Zealand dunes. So dunes clad with native vegetation work better and look better. Which leads us to the next example. And I come to a different logic of dune restoration. So erosion control has been the initial goal of coast care, and it remains an important motivation for many coast carers. But increasingly, native plants are planted not only to stabilize the four dunes and counter the effects of coastal erosion. More and more people are interested in restoring native biodiversity in its own right. So this provides a clear contrast to the historic attempts to deliberately introduce species into the former British colony, a practice that used to be called acclimatization. The growing interest in native plants coincides with the renaissance of Maori culture. For example, the endemic plant pingau, here on the right, is very effective in building fort dunes, but it is also an important resource for traditional indigenous weaving techniques, which are now often also mentioned in the context of dune restoration. Another example is the popularity of an origin story about the pingau plant, in which pingau represents the eyebrows of Tane, the god of the forest. So as a short version of the story is that Tane was fighting with his brother Tangaroa, the god of the seas. As a sign to end this fight, Tane threw his eyebrows onto the shore, where they turned into the pingau plant. You can see that it looks a bit like that, right? Since then, the pingau marks the border between the land and the sea. This story of Tane's eyebrows is printed in coast care brochures, which in fact mostly cater to a Pākehā audience, which is New Zealanders of European descent. But actually, there are also Māori-led projects of coastal restoration work, which praise the natural and cultural value of native plants and act this out in the scope of coast care. So native plants are, in the words of a lady, engaged in coastal and river restoration, culturally and naturally good for Maori. So coast care emerges here as a practice that allows people to work together on restoring Aotearoa New Zealand's distinctive coastal landscapes. This quote here is from a representative of the Dune Restoration Trust of New Zealand. And it directly connects dune restoration to the reconstruction of native landscape. So he said on a radio show, quote, "I used to say I wanted New Zealand to be like Aotearoa and not like a mini England. And that was what we worked on." The trust also changed its name this year. It is now called a Coastal Restoration Trust, to reflect that its mission is not only to address coastal sand dunes, but coastal environments in a larger sense and scope and variety as well. So New Zealand's beaches and coasts are central markers of national identity. They are only among the few freely accessible public spaces. So in this third example, or third logic, dune restoration has been used as a way to reclaim the dunes as part of the public space of the beach. The beachfront properties that you can see here sit along a long stretch of suburban beach outside the port city of Tauranga. They have been encroaching onto the dunes. That means that their lawns and gardens and decks have been extended into the coastal reserve, which is a public space where the dune begins. Everybody sort of did it. People may not have known their exact property boundaries. At least this practice was tolerated over a very long period of time. At some point, though, the city council decided that the encroachments had to be removed. So everybody was sent a letter. Was informed that they could sort of that they had to remove everything, or that they could go to court if they're not okay with that. And then contractors were brought in that removed the existing structures with heavy machinery and sprayed herbicides everywhere. After that, Coastcare was enlisted to finalize the project. Because of the size of the project, and in order to progress quickly along several kilometers of coastline, volunteer labor was organized differently in this case. So the dunes were cleared and sprayed, cleared and prepared for planting by people on periodic detention, so-called PD workers, serving community hours, for example, for non-payment of fines. To free a dune of existing vegetation, to get rid of the weeds and especially the roots, is a very tiring task. But when the community workers were finished with preparing the dunes, they were ready for quick and easy planting. And quick success seemed also quite important for the public approval of this controversial project. So most of the planting was then done by groups of local school children and scouts. So on the picture on the left, you can see them literally standing on something that was once somebody else's back garden. And on the right, you can see the same area just looking into the other direction, dunes completely covered with native vegetation. So with my last example, I'll leave dune restoration and come to a soft engineering approach called the multipurpose reef. On the picture in the middle, you can see such a reef, which has been constructed by a former New Zealand company called ASR. Artificial surfing reef, actually, that means. The reef is built from large geotextile bags. It is the same material that you can see here on the right, but the bags are much, much bigger. The structure is submerged up offshore and builds this reef made out of big individual bags. This technology relies on techno-scientific progress, on the rise of coastal science as a discipline, on the development of new materials, and advances in computer modeling and 3D graphics. The scientists and engineers at ASR argue that they are able to understand nature by measuring and modeling it. Their aim was to find out how the mechanisms of sediment distribution work in a specific place and then change these coastal processes in a way that leads to a wider beach forming as a way of what they called coastal engineering working in concert with natural processes. So the multipurpose reef is meant to do three things: to enhance marine biodiversity by providing habitat, and to influence the currents in a way that accumulates more sand on the beach, and at the same time enhances surfing conditions. So the latter is an all-surface stream, and it was also the unique selling point of the reefs. The idea of commercial scale soft protection provided convincing for investors, for the engineers, and also for local councils. But when the reefs did not perform as intended, the surfing aspect became the major inroad for critique as well. So multipurpose reefs both in New Zealand and in the UK have been regarded as failures in this respect, the surfing aspect. However, importantly, ASR have promoted an image as surface scientists, claiming that the shared experience of being out in the water matters for the work of coastal protection. So I will show you a short video. It was a commercial video of the company that sort of demonstrates this narrative.
Hi, my name's Chris Jensen.
I'm Nick Behunin.
We run a company called ASR, which is the world leader in design and construction of multipurpose reefs.
The reefs we build inspire marine habitats to prosper, produce surfable waves, and defend our coastlines from erosion.
What drives us is protecting what is precious to us and many people around the world. We work in concert with nature.
Instead of building ugly seawalls, we are building our geotextile reefs, which are far less intrusive than seawalls.
One of our most recent reefs was built in India. With the help of local workers and the strength of a local elephant named Sasha, we successfully constructed this reef underwater and offshore.
Nature makes good reefs. We want to reproduce it. We want to understand how nature works. We've gone out, we've measured the shape of the seabed under reefs. What we've been able to do is find what makes reefs so perfect.
The people in our company and all of us, you know, we're surfers and we really understand and love this environment.
We go and we enter the water on an almost daily basis. We interact with the ocean and we take that overriding experience into what we do.
We want to have an impact on how our coastlines and our beaches are managed.
Making waves, saving beaches, and helping people.
On the journey, we surf, we visit new places, and always work hard to enhance coastal communities around the world.
Hallelujah!
We got a big, important meeting in a few hours.
Showering to go meet the mayor.
You get a ticket for bathing naked.
It's actually quite a realistic depiction of this. So I was doing an internship at this company, and they had this, in the middle of the day, people were disappearing and saying they were having a board meeting, which meant they were going out surfing. Yeah. So I come to the final part of the argument. I have tried to open up a nature-culture perspective on coastal protection. Instead of making a clear separation between the nature and the culture of the coast, I have argued to take serious the material practices in which natures or nature cultures are made. The coastal protection projects I've shown you may follow different internal logics, but they all produce and reproduce natural and cultural orders. So for dune restoration projects to function as do-it-yourself, cost-effective approaches to erosion control, they have to rely on people understanding coastal erosion as a natural process. Working with nature in this regard means to work with an environment in constant flux. Dune restoration used as a soft protection technique cannot settle things once and for all. Ongoing maintenance may be required. Dune scrapings might need to be repeated after major storm events, and they only work if erosion is understood as cyclical and not as a singular event. Coastal vegetation that has been washed away has to be replaced. But there's also a general maintenance work needed. Weeding and pest control have to be done regularly in order to protect the dune plants. So using dune restoration as soft protection hinges on the understanding that native plants are perfectly adapted to this environment, yet at the same time threatened and in the need of human assistance. Or more generally, that Aotearoa New Zealand coastal nature needs constant care and maintenance work. So dune restoration involves a massive amount of human labor, which in New Zealand is almost exclusively carried out by volunteers. So this widespread engagement of people in nature conservation groups such as Coast Care also shows and relies on a remarkable willingness of the population to contribute this volunteer nature work. As the second example shows, many dune restoration projects now care for native dune vegetation in its own right. The objective is to reintroduce and to protect a specific Aotearoa New Zealand coastal nature. I have called this practice the reconstruction of native nature. And this coast care becomes part of a larger social development. The emergent interest in native nature can be understood as a symptom of a changing national identity as well. So Aotearoa New Zealand now perceives itself as a bicultural nation, Maori and European or Pakeha. And it increasingly defines itself by the role that native culture and nature play in this. So native nature, I want to argue, has become an important signifier of a desirable common future, a future with biculturalism emerging as the distinctive feature of Aotearoa New Zealand. The anti-encroachment project shows how dune restoration is used by the local authorities as a means to reclaim the dunes as a public space for nature. The project reinforces property boundaries by removing privatized garden spaces and reinstalling a dune ecosystem. At the same time, the public space of the beach is tied to an understanding of the right state of coastal nature. It is one that features native, sand-binding vegetation and functional dunes, and not the pretty garden flowers introduced from elsewhere. This project also shows a large economy of volunteer labor involved into coast care projects. So using people from the criminal justice system to prepare the dunes also has a probably unintended side effect of underlining that this project is about enforcing boundaries, because the offenders are also sanctioned for their overstepping of other boundaries. The enrollment of school children for planting events further underlines the public interest of this project. The multi-purpose reef project is also visionary in its own sense. This example shows that working with nature is not bound to categories like low or high tech in any simple way. While dune restoration can be achieved with relatively simple means and mostly relying on physical labor, the reefs are an investment into a resource-intensive and costly approach. Here, nature is understood through techno-scientific means, with the goal to simply manipulate it in order to produce better conditions, surfing conditions, broader beaches and marine habitat. Though this approach is framed as a way of enhancing nature. However, nature is not limited to numbers and functions alone here. The proponents of the Artificial Reef Company claim that their shared experience of surfing provides another layer of tacit understanding of nature. So they subscribe to a surfing ethos that they argue translates into an environmental consciousness. The multipurpose reef approach remains experimental and had mixed success. However, the idea is persuasive exactly because of its promise to work in concert with natural processes on a commercial scale and with reference to latest techno-scientific developments. So finally, I would like to address the political consequences of this plurality of coastal natures, which I have described. I think this is very important for at least two reasons. So first, the working with nature imaginary does not belong only to these enthusiastic dune carers and coastal experts and surface scientists that I have shown you. Working with nature is an increasingly powerful idea or social technical imaginary when it comes to describe coastal futures. There's, for example, the Dutch public-private consortium EcoShape and its Building with Nature program. You may be aware of the flagship project of Building with Nature, the sand engine, where off the South Holland coast, a large amount of sand was used to create a peninsula, which is expected to distribute the sand to the beaches over the next 20 years without further human intervention, instead of repeated beach nourishments every 5 years. The latest is a large public-private project in Indonesia for building with mangroves as a soft coastal protection strategy. So in this project, sediment will be trapped by dams constructed from brushwood, and then mangroves are expected to naturally reseed the area and provide natural protection against erosion and flooding. The project, I quote from the website, represents the transition of traditional infrastructure designs that typically fight against nature towards solutions that work with and alongside nature. But building with nature is also about establishing a new philosophy in hydraulic engineering. This new philosophy dismisses the logic of compensation areas for the damage caused by infrastructural projects. Instead, the argument goes, infrastructure engineering may lead to a net gain in environmental value, making for more or better nature than before. So the outcome is that nature enhanced and not compromised by human intervention. So this is actually leading to the second point, that these approaches are also actually working with sort of a field theory of multiple natures or social natures. So the Building with Nature strategy claims that, quote, man-made projects are an inherent part of the environment. That this is a concept of nature that is pretty similar to understanding natural and social worlds as co-produced. And this can be used to different ends. So this is basically the point that I want to make. So for example, a lobby organization for port development here on the right, PAANC, has developed its own strategy paper of working with nature, where they argue that navigation development projects can create win-win solutions that are, quote, benefiting navigation and nature. So this becomes very sort of, the step becomes very close between it's sort of a shorthand for that Well, basically I want to argue to sort of not take this as the end of the analysis, right? So it's a shorthand that works in different contexts. So it works in these very nice and benign contexts, but it can be used also by powerful actors that have strategic goals. So, and this is why I put Steve Hinchliffe on here again, so who reminds us that if you pluralize nature, that you do away with this idea of capital and natures. And then you can also not use it anymore as a common political cause in any simple way anymore. So any appeal to work with nature, I would argue, has to be followed with the question, which natures do you want? So this is why the empirical work of ethnography can contribute to making explicit what natures people are working towards. So figuring out what is actually done, by whom, and how, and what the outcomes are, and who profits or benefits, or who or what is left out of these projects of nature making. Or put differently, it can analyze coastal protection and related practices as practical politics of nature. Thank you.